Hello and welcome to another video. I am Dave, and I am using a voice created through AI. Today we look at drawing symmetry. This small but powerful setup allows to create complex symmetrical figures with just a few strokes. I am currently doing some brainstorming what interesting tools one can build to utilize a tablet pen. For that research I got myself a Wacom Intuos Pro. I remembered seeing different applications doing symmetry drawing.
And those sure look awesome. We should build that in Houdini, dude.
That was the plan.
Well, it turns out to be way easier than this guy thought, but it is still an interesting setup to share.
So first go ahead and create a draw curve node. This is basically a stroke sop node, with some additional functionality wrapped around it. Your strokes are directly projected onto a plane. Let's turn it to the ZX plane so that we can use the top perspective. Now if we take a look at the spreadsheet, you can see that there already are attributes meant to save pen data. Stroke angle, pressure, tilt and even timing data. I just used the mouse so the attributes have a default value. When I use the pen and create a few lines, you can see that it gathers the data from the pen. It then saves it in those attributes. So no Python needed. We come back to that later.
I sure hope you come up with some clever stuff instead. Without Python, this almost feels worthless.
Relax. For now, let's create something to help us to draw smoother lines. Depending on the precision of your pen, you will notice that the curve is fairly jagged. One way to make that curve smoother is to first unrefine it. That might sound counterproductive, but you will see that it does work quite nicely. So let's create the refine sop node. I set the values from 0 to 1 and switch to the unrefine tab. And for now, let's keep it at the default value. And create a resample next. Here we have the option to create subdivision curves, and already we get a smoother output. When you draw the curve, it adds the points in a quite chaotic pattern. By unrefining it first, we get sections with lesser points. These sections get the most effect by the resample. When I increase the tolerance, more and more points are deleted by the unrefine, which gives the resample more room to work with. But as you can see, this will change the output dramatically over your input.
If it doesn't look like my own input, what is the point?
Let me explain. Small movements are basically ignored. For example, with this extreme setting, even if I draw a circle, the movement is lost. So you need to adjust the setting according to the size of the movement, in relation to the world space, that is. If I lower the tolerance just right, I get back the movement, while the resample still gives me a smooth result. With the right setting, I am able to draw very smooth curves, but still be very close to my original input.
So smooth.
Now let's continue with the symmetry tool itself. The idea is to draw a curve and have it mirrored at the center axis. The mirror node is perfect for that. Let's reset the curve and try it out. And that seems to work fine. But we want the mirror effect multiple times, each time at a different angle. If we look at an initial shape, like a leaf for example, we want to do something with it. So next comes a copy and transform node. This will allow us to create the different patterns. When you increase the number of copies, they will lay on top of each other. With the rotation, however, you can now move each mirrored stroke around until you cover the whole 360 degrees. With 8, that makes an angle of 45.
Well, that is great and all, but how should I know where to draw and where it will copy stuff around?
That is a good point. What all of these applications for drawing have in common are guidelines that show you where exactly the mirroring happens. To create those lines, we start with a simple line. I start with the Z-axis. We make it really long, like 100 units, but we do want it at the center, similar on how you would bring a box to stand on the zero plane. I copy the length parameter and paste it into the origin but divide it by 2. That pushes the line away from the center, so we negate the whole statement.
Okay, now we have a big ash line. What are we going to do with it?
Now we need another copy and transform for the lines as well. Simply Alt-drag the node over. But you can see that it is not quite correct. When we have the same values in that second copy node, there is an overlap in the same region. When I draw the line, the mirrored side of another copy reaches into this area. Each area should be left alone.
Exactly. Stop touching my area.
But it does make sense to copy the parameters from it. We can keep the number of copies, as it is, but when we grab the rotation, we divide it by 2. Now if we take a closer look at the guidelines, you will notice that each drawn line stays in its own area. Again, you can see how we only get a very average result. But that's only the case since we are fairly zoomed in. When we make bigger movements, it is better. With just 3 strokes, we already have something more complex. And now this begins to show its potential, something where Houdini can play its strengths. We can now change our number of copies and the rotation as we wish to. The result is an even more complex shape.
Wow, it is so beautiful. I can't believe it. You get that this is sarcasm, right?
Now, if we don't want to play with irregular angles, we can make sure to always use the correct rotation by setting it to 360, divided by the amount of copies. That way we only have to adjust one single setting. Another interesting effect can be created if we do the copy without the mirror. Currently, if I draw a line, its copy is going to meet me at the guideline. If I deactivate the mirror, I get a different kind of result. Now I just repeat my input with a rotational offset. But it is still possible to activate the mirror afterwards. The result still looks as if it was intended that way. And now with the parameters connected, I can change the number to quickly test for different styles. Now to the pen data. To draw the shapes, a pen is not required, but it gives you the option to do various things with it. Let's create a wrangle and do something. As an example, I am going to use the pressure. For good measure, I read the attribute stroke pressure, and for starters, we could pick a color with it. The pressure is always between 0 and 1, so I can use fit 01 and remap the value to any color value I might want to see. Then, we could define the width of the lines with a ramp, call it thickness, and use the pressure as the indicator. And in addition to that, we might want to displace our position according to the pressure. We could push the point up, the harder we press the pen while drawing it. Now back in the wrangle, we can now create the ramp parameters and change the ramp curves for different looks. Maybe something smooth for the thickness and a bit more abrupt for the displacement. Let's draw a new example, and this time I try to use different pressure in between.
So you are basically sticking it in there real hard, don't you? Damn it, AI voices are so much fun to play with.
Looking from the side, we can see how parts of the curves are pushed up. That's where I pressed a little bit harder. With something to look at, we can play with the ramp to get something that becomes interesting. But I guess the idea is clear. Now to use the width, we could use a polywire and directly use the width attribute we created. This will in general give you geometry that tapers off when you lift the pen. Let's clear that once again. If you go a bit closer and press down the pen a bit harder, the effect gets more obvious.
Must not do more inappropriate jokes.
Another possibility could be some basic point manipulation. Let's create a new shape, maybe a bit more chaotic and bigger this time. Create another wrangle for a classic vex line. We increase the position in Y by the following formula. Point number divided by the amount of points, with a multiplier at the end. Remember to change both of these numbers to float, to prevent rounding. Pick something big like 8 to see an effect. By default, the points are sorted according to their creation. We need to sort our points differently if we are after a different outcome. To do that, we create a simple sort node. In this case, the easiest would be to sort by proximity to the center. The way it is set up, that pushes the outer points up. If you want the opposite, simply reverse the point order. This again allows for some interesting shapes. Yet another way this could be used would be to deliberately break open the construct. Let's make some circular forms. Now I want to create a gap. This can be done by changing the rotation to something smaller than needed to close the circle. Drawing with this setting is getting a bit unpredictable, but it is an interesting shape for sure. Now, if we combine all of that, we get a very simple tool that can quickly create amazing shapes with small effort on our part.
You heard the man. Here you have an amazing tool. Create amazing shapes by using minimal effort. The ultimate goal of any developer that ever lived. I could do this all day. Don't forget to subscribe and hit the bell notification. This is what YouTuber people say, and now this voice will keep reminding you to do so. You could also join Dave's Patreon for some additional content, or don't, whatever floats your boat. What are you still doing here? The video is over.